I'm looking forward to present to you our work on how to reconcile tight bounds and overheads in constrained data edge systems with job level dependencies. This work was done together with Matthias Becker, Wolfgang Schüler-Breitschert, and Peter Ulbricht. Cause-effect chains are a typical pattern in real-world applications. Though several software tasks jointly fulfill a functionality, they are specified independently without precedence constraints. Communication between such tasks is done by register communication, where producers write results to shared memory and consumers read from there. As no explicit synchronization is established, a last best semantics is employed for the messages. This approach simplifies specification and distributed development, as for example in the concurrent engineering paradigm. However, as these cause-effect chains often are part of a controlled application, the end-to-end delay of such chains is crucial for application's performance. Here, guaranteeing a tight upper bound from the beginning of the input task to the end of the output task is often more important than meeting the task deadlines themselves. To discuss some as cause-effect chains are widespread in the in industry, there are a lot of approaches to executing them. Here I want to discuss some of the established concepts at hand of this example system. We have four communicating tasks, tau 1 to tau 4. There, the communication direction is from top to bottom. The most straightforward execution pattern is integrating cause-effect chains just as they are, as they were specified with last best semantics. This comes with some advantages, as each task can be considered as an isolated run-to-completion task without further constraints. That means that we have minimal runtime overhead during execution. Additionally, since no further constraints exist, the schedulability of such simple implementations is superior to more complex approaches. However, as we can see here, these advantages come with a price when considering the chain's data propagation path. The chain's data edge experience many jitters, as the data of the first job, tau 1, here, could be used by all depicted jobs of tau 4. Additionally, the worst case analysis is even worse than depicted here. Consider a case where the second job of tau 3 overtakes the third job of tau 4. Then the chain's output could be as late as the end of the fourth period of tau 4. An approach to tackle data age jitter and increase the predictability of data ages is the logical execution time, short LET. Here, data propagation is precisely timed at periods beginnings and ends. Computational parts are separated and can be executed in between. This pattern increases predictability, as it clarifies which jobs consumes data from which producer job, but induces no additional synchronization overhead and eliminates jitter. Unfortunately, predictable means here that the data age always reaches the worst case by design. Additionally, this execution model needs support from the operating system or the programming language and induces context switches, as read and write blocks are separated from computing blocks, decreasing schedulability. Another approach that first of all tries to improve the worst case data age bounds of the cause-effect chains are job level dependencies, or short JLDs. Here, constructive synchronizations are selectively introduced between job instances of tasks such that the worst data propagation path are prohibited and the remaining worst case data ages are improved. However, implementing and executing job level dependencies are rather complex, as inducing additional conditional synchronization is not straightforward without a specialized operating system. Especially when considering software evolution and product lines, such synchronization has to be anticipated for each job and increases WCT. The additional WCT, as well as the dependency constraints, make schedulability analysis more complex and pessimistic. Additionally, during runtime scheduling, overheads and additional context switches occur. As this comparison shows, developers are stuck between a hard and a rock place, as they have to choose between minimizing data ages, minimizing overheads, or increasing schedulability. Therefore, we identified the following challenges for our work. We want to keep runtime overheads comparable to time-triggered execution. Predictability and upper bound of data ages should be comparable to explicit synchronization with JLDs. Schedulability should be comparable to when implicit communication is employed. And all this should be easy to use and incorporatable in existing development processes. As Arne already told, this is somehow kind of a free lunch here. To tackle these challenges, we chose a tool-based approach to leverage static code analysis and system transformation that incorporates the following. Automatic tailoring of task implementation, task parameter optimization, scheduling enhancing transformations, and an adapted maximum data age analysis. As a first step into our approach, I would like to present to you a quick overview of the tool that that we implemented here. We implemented this in the real-time systems compiler, which is a LVM-based tool to analyze and transform real-time systems. It takes most importantly the task code of real-time systems, which are enriched by timing properties, and in our case by JLDs. These are further analyzed by, for example, the WCT analysis, which can be run at option. And so the transformation within the tool and within our implementation, I don't want to explain any further because some of them are a part of this talk. The most important part of the RTSC is that it's actually designed to output executable systems targeting different operating systems. So we extended this possibility by a dynamic data logging system and adjustable load function so that we can measure data ages under various load fractions. To actually show the transformations we did within the RTSC, I would like to come back to our example from the beginning. Please note that these are not the real, not exactly the real transformations, as these are more complicated, but only more or less as they want to give you an impression of what we're doing to achieve our goals. If you look at the example, we have a data chain that is fully sequentialized by constructive synchronizations. This means that if we would consider these tasks as these jobs as task itself, this would be easy and it would just be a sequentialized task. Therefore, we do this. We unroll all related jobs and consider them as tasks by themselves with their own timing properties, retaining the execution windows. And as you can see here, as they have to execute behind each other, and the dynamic possibilities of the constructive synchronization is more or less superfluous because it's totally clear that tau 3 job 2 has to run after tau 2 job 3. We can concatenate the implementations of these two tasks and create a new one with their own timing properties. For now, we have left out the I/O task, the input and the output task, to optimize them later on more adventurously. For now, we also take a temporal property preserving approach here. That means that the newly merged task retains has timing properties such that none of the included tasks will violate its release time or its deadline. As you can see here, this has no further effect for the job of tau 2, but it tightens the execution window of tau 3 here massively. But we'll come to this later. Additionally, we have, as I've noted, we left out the I/O task, so we had to, so we still have the explicit coordinations here. These can be adjusted by adapting the real release times and deadlines of each of these three tasks, such that they are implicitly coordinated. However, not much is won by now, as the data age is still the same and schedulability has decreased at best. Now we have to look at the timing properties of each task for itself. As I've noted in the introduction, timing of compute tasks is unimportant. As long as the data ages, that means the interaction with the outer world is short and stays below a certain data age constraint. So we take this observation to further increase to further optimize the timing properties of the newly merged tasks. Here, first of all, we maximize the timing from the property from the timing the win execution window of the computational task, such that it violates the release time of the deadline of tau 2, but it retains stays part of the original data chain. Additionally, this is a second step, which is done later on in the after allocation has already been done. We are tightening the deadlines. of the I/O task such that they are that the soul system keeps stays schedulable, and that the deadlines are as tight as possible. In the best case, as depicted here, they're exactly like the WCT, which means that they don't have any execution jitter at all. And here now, with this adapted timing properties, you can see that the maximum data age has just decreased. This looks rather simple in this in our small example with only two tasks and one chain, and could be done by hand and could be done for all the simple tasks where we have one sequential line of data chains. However, the real world looks more complex. So we have things like here, where we have several batches of sequential tasks that we identified that could be merged, and we have crossing chains where the data chain shares some tasks, and we have as you can see here, these can also be parallelized, so a parallelization strategy is needed. As a little teaser, we again chose the implicit synchronization for cross-core synchronization, but the details are left in. I would like to keep in the paper so you can read it up afterwards. As you see, and there are lots of different steps and lot of optimizations that are implemented within the tool, and a lot of situations. So we came up with a lot of variants that we wanted to compare. There are some variants known from literature that we wanted to compare us. Most importantly, plane, as this is the last is best semantic introduced before. JLDs as JLDs with explicitly synchronized jobs. And some optimizations and merged variants, and the combination of those. We will discuss them a little bit later. To start the evaluation, I just want to give you some numbers of the runtime of our of the RTSC to see to show its applicability. Therefore, we used synthetic systems with 433 synthetic systems with a utilization between 0.6 and 2, with various periods and task number from 95 to 1,000. Each of this system contained data chains 1 to 3 data chains. As you can see, we have a rather linear scaling of the runtimes of the RTSC, and there is and the times, especially the average times for large tasks, that's like thousands tasks, is rather acceptable with 100 seconds. The worst case with 250 seconds should still be acceptable if you don't run it every second. So it's there, some interactive work should be done, could be done here. The more important thing on what our tool does it hold its promises. So we took these synthetic systems and put different variants of our optimizations on these systems. For comparison, here we have the schedulability these have been scheduled for 2 cores. So this explains why utilization of 2 is more or less the maximum that we examined. We have 2 graphs depicted here. One is the plane, the last is best semantics. It has a superior schedulability. And here is the upper bound of the graph. This is JLD with less schedulability. Now our variance. As you can see, we started here with just merging. That this increases schedulability from JLD as we get rid of the explicit synchronizations. Then, when we use this maximization of execution windows, we are getting rather close to we are getting better. And if we combine a lot of our optimizations, that means we're expanding the execution window. We're using our multi-core optimizations, and we're using the optimization. We're really close to plain last is best semantics. I'll hurry up as I've seen it. I've been over time already. So the next thing that we did was a case study from the Waters Industrial Challenge with 3 chains. We allocated and scheduled them for 4 cores. And for first of all, and most importantly, we executed them. Here you can see execution traces of the data ages. So and this is the analysis of the traditional JLD aware analysis that doesn't take into account the actual execution times as we adjusted them. And this is our analysis. You can see here that it's more tight, and you can see especially that we are having a drawback if you're employing the maximum windows execution windows. But this is all settled by employing the opt variants. So in the conclusion, we have runtime overheads without explicit synchronizations. So this is comparable to time triggered execution. We have predicted the data age just as with JLD. We have a schedulability that is comparable to implicit communication if we combine all of our optimizations. And we think the tool is easy to use, so and especially it doesn't need any special OS. Thank you for watching me, and sorry for being too long.